Good morning. This is Pastor Larry. It's Tuesday, November the 14th here in the Philadelphia, Pennsylvania area. I'm actually in New Jersey, right across the bridge. But our church is El Shaddai Christian Assembly. It's located 1448 Greenwood Street in Philadelphia, Pennsylvania, 19150. If you want to get in touch with the office at the church, 215-927-7188. If you want to email me directly, you can email me at pastor. The letter L, the letter SHADDAI at gmail.com. And we're appreciate you being on our channel. And every Tuesday I try to put out whatever the Holy Spirit puts on my heart. And I believe it's beneficial. You can never not advance in the kingdom and in the spiritual life if you won't. I guess I'm using a double negative. But whenever you hear the word or hear something from the Lord, it's always to our benefit, is really what I'm trying to say. Instead of a double negative, what I was saying, never not. So I apologize for that. I'm not an English teacher or English major. But listen, I want to share a couple things today. And if you're looking for a title, the title is, Do You Actually Know What You Think You Know? So there's a couple of things that's going to come out as a result of that. But we hear things and we've heard things over our spiritual life that they had a basis in the truth, but it wasn't the whole truth. And I think about that scripture in Daniel chapter 12, verse 4, also in 1 Corinthians 13. But let me turn to Daniel chapter 12. It's just one verse I'm going to read, and I like that scripture because it's appropriate for where we are. And Daniel's getting a vision, and it says, But thou, O Daniel, verse 4, shut up the words and seal the book, even to the time of the end. And it says, Many shall run to and fro. And then here's the part I really like. It says, And knowledge shall be increased. So we know more today than we did in the past, and especially in the end times, it seems like we're going to know even more. Like things that there will be things that are being uncovered that that we didn't know before, and I guess even just because of scholarship, the discipline of scholarship, how well that has moved along, and so those things are some of the things that's propelling our knowledge forward. I remember reading a book, or I have a book, I didn't read the whole book, but it was saying that they called it the 5,000-year leap, where all of a sudden knowledge just increased, it doubled after a 5,000-year interlude where it didn't, and then it just kept on going, and it's going even more and more now. I was looking to see if that scripture in 1 Corinthians 13, where it says, we know in verse 12 of chapter 13, 1 Corinthians, it says, For now we see through a glass darkly, but then face to face. And then it says, now I know in part, but then I shall know even as also I am known. And again, I believe that's for once we are with our Savior, but even we can still take that principle and recognize that we only know in part. Like just for example, you start driving. Once you start driving, you're not the most experienced driver. You don't know everything. You need knowledge. You need wisdom, which is applying that knowledge. But day one, you don't know everything there is to know about driving. Or someone who becomes a doctor or a lawyer. Day one, they don't know everything there is to know about being a doctor or a lawyer. As a matter of fact, I want to put this out there too. And I'm saying this not picking on this field, but doctors. Do you know that they have a thing called malpractice insurance? And the reason why they have malpractice insurance is because even though they've studied, even though they've gone to school, they still are human beings, and they still are subject to making mistakes or having a belief of something that's not correct. And I'm saying that because just because you become a pastor or a teacher or evangelist or prophet or apostle or whatever you want to call, whatever title you, that title doesn't confer absolute knowledge on you or absolute wisdom. And so there's pastors and teachers that have been sharing things, and myself included, for years. And now all of a sudden, like I said, it says in the latter times, knowledge will be increased. So let me turn to Genesis 15:13. Genesis chapter 15, verse 13. This is when Yahweh was establishing his covenant with Abraham. Abraham had already moved into the area where he told him to go. And he says, listen to this, verse 13. Because Abraham wanted to know, how will he know that he can, he would have, well, let me just go read it. Verse 13. And he said unto Abraham, know of a surety that thy seed shall be a stranger in a land that is not theirs, and shall serve them, and they shall afflict them 400 years. Now, there's a couple of things to unpack in there. I'm not going to go into everything, but Abraham has no kids. His name is still Abram. And he says, and this is Yahweh, the Father, telling him, he says, listen, know of a surety that your seed, so you're going to have seed, Abraham, or Abram, know of a surety that your seed, and not only are you going to know for certain that you will have seed, but your seed is going to be a stranger in a land that is not theirs, and shall serve them, and they shall afflict them 400 years. And also that nation whom they shall serve will I judge, and afterwards shall they come out with great substance. And so us in our impartial knowledge have applied that promise or that word from Yahweh. We applied it to the children of Israel from when they were in Egypt. And then here's another scripture I want to read that we've taken as well. Exodus chapter 12, verse 40. Exodus chapter 12, verse 40. I'm going to read this. Now the sojourning of the children of Israel who dwelt in Egypt was 430 years. And it came to pass at the end of 430 years, even the selfsame day, it came to pass that all the hosts of the Lord went out from the land of Egypt. I happen to have the benefit of a Bible that predates, the Greek Septuagint predates the King James, or where the Latin Vulgate, and that, as, along with the Samaritan Pentateuch and the Greek Septuagint, both say that they were in Canaan 215 years and Egypt 215 years. Basically, it's combining the two. So that even if it doesn't combine it, it still doesn't match up with the 400 years that Yahweh mentioned in Genesis chapter 15, verse 13. And I believe that Yahweh invented math, and he knows how to count. If he says 400 years, I believe he meant 400 years and not 430. Let's go to one of the first examples that shows you that there is something that we were misinterpreting. Here in Galatians chapter 3, again, we're talking about, do you know what you think you know? Galatians chapter 3, listen, this is Paul. And again, Paul had the advantage of having older manuscripts. He knew Hebrew. He had access to things that weren't written at this point that we read today. And here's what Paul is saying. He says, and this I say, that the covenant, which we just read in Genesis 15, the covenant with Abraham, that was confirmed before of God in Christ, the law, which was 430 years after, cannot disannul. So the law came with Moses when they left Egypt 430 years after the covenant. The covenant was with Abraham. Abraham was not in Egypt at that time. So that 430 years does not match up. And we're going to go a little further. But anyway, it says, and this I say, I'm going to read it again, that the covenant, which was with Abraham when he went into Canaan, that was confirmed before of God in Christ, the law, which was 430 years after, cannot disannul, that it should make the promise of God of none effect. And there's some other scriptures, but I want to talk about the Hebrew timeline. And like, for example, today, this year, right now, we're in the Hebrew year 5784. They go by the year since Adam was born, 5784. So according to the Hebrew tradition and on their calendar, and you can find this on chabad.org, the Hebrew timeline, it says that we are in the year 5784. Adam died in the year 930, and if you read in the scripture, you'll see that after 930 years, Adam died. So Adam died the year 930. The flood was the year 1656. I'm just giving you a couple of points just so that you can follow how they did their math and how they kept their history. Abraham was born, and this is interesting, in the year 1948, from the beginning of time is what they assume, not 1948 BC or AD. This is 1948. They don't add the BC because they don't believe in that the Messiah has come. But so 1948 was when Abraham was born. And Abraham went into Canaan in the year 2023. Isn't that interesting? He went into Canaan in the year 2023. Joseph was sold into slavery in the year 2216. And again, it's a cumulative. They don't do that division like we do where we do BC and AD. Jacob, Joseph's father, came into Egypt in the year 2238. And it says Israel left Egypt 2448. So according to their own tradition, the Hebrew tradition, and what they keep on their timeline, and if you do the math, if you see when Abraham went in, how old he was when he had Isaac, he was 100. Isaac was 60 when he had Jacob. And so you figure, okay, so Abraham went into Canaan when he was 75. He had Isaac when he was 100. That was 25. And then Isaac was 60 when he had Jacob. So you figure 25 plus 60 is 85. Jacob was 130 when he went into Egypt. So 130 plus the 85 is 215. So that's the 215 years that coincides with the Greek Septuagint, and as well as the Samaritan Pentateuch. And even Josephus says the same thing. He was a historian. So that was 215 years. And there's also so much other proof that shows you who went into Egypt with them. And you know that there's no physical way, based on their ages, that they would have been there longer than 215 years. But again, according to the Hebrew calendar, their timeline, Israel left Egypt in the year 2448, and they went in 2238. That's only a difference of 210 years. So there's some other stuff that we'll get into. But let's turn to Luke chapter 21. Because this is another thing that we don't always pay attention, I guess. I know I didn't, and so I'm assuming that other people are like me. They're human as well. Again, that's why doctors have malpractice insurance. That's why no matter, you can be a believer, but every one of us believers has been wrong on some point at some time. Just like science thought the world was flat. And a whole bunch of other things we won't get into. But Luke 21, verse 24. This is the Messiah describing what will happen after the fall of Jerusalem. They asked him, and he's talking about the end times as well. And he says, and they shall fall by the edge of the sword. He's talking about his people. And his people shall be led away captive into a couple of nations. No, it says into all nations. And Jerusalem shall be trodden down of the Gentiles until the time of the Gentiles be fulfilled. So here's something I want to say is at this time when the Messiah is talking, he's not talking to all of Israel, because Israel had been dispersed. The northern kingdom had already been dissipated. And the only people that were still there in the land pretty much were the southern kingdom, which is why they called it Jews or Judah. That's where that came from. That term came from Judah. They were basically, the southern kingdom was, the majority was Judah, but there were some of the other kingdoms, other nations, other families or tribes of Israel were there at the same time. But right now it was really Judah. That's why they call them Jews. Anyway, so at this time, he's only talking to the people that were remaining, not from the northern kingdom. So it wasn't even all of Israel that he's talking about and talking to. And the event he's talking about occurs after once the fall of Jerusalem, which was around 70 AD, and I guess it was General Vespasian. And it seems to relate to the statement about them being captive in Genesis 15:13 that he's talking about now. So this happened after they were out of Egypt. And it says, he says that you'll be led captive into all nations. And it didn't, that would not have been just the Egyptian servitude. They couldn't be captive in every nation if they were only in Egypt. So the Egyptian servitude, which was around Hebrew year, like I said, 2332 is when the servitude actually started after Joseph had died. It said a king arose who didn't know Joseph. So, and it was really, if you look at their Hebrew timeline, it says after Levi died, that's when the slavery started. And that wasn't that long according to their timeline. But and it would have been according to our time in the year 1429 BC before Christ is when that servitude would have started, would have commenced. So anyway, Yeshua is talking about something that's going to happen. His people will be led captive into all nations after the fall of Jerusalem. Now, there's more to that. I don't want to get into all that now, but I just wanted to show you that we think we know things, or we believe we know things, and sometimes we don't know it because we haven't put all the characters or pictures together. But when we take our time and divest ourselves of ourselves and of the narrative that we've been told before, then what will happen is we allow the Holy Spirit and the Word of Yahweh to be what is the final arbiter of what's truth. And that's how you'll know what you think you know, not what you've been taught, what you've heard. We even read in the Bible. I showed you in the Bible, and with Paul, and also I could have went through each scripture that showed the timeline in the Bible according to how old Isaac was, how old Jacob was when they went in, as well as in Genesis shows who they went in with, and you'll see that it was a very short list because I'll throw this out there since I'm here. Levi was Jacob's son. Levi went in with his son, which was Jacob's grandson, which was his son was Kohath. Went into Egypt. It says that in Genesis, went in with his dad, Levi, Kohath. Kohath had a son named Amram. Amram was the father of Moses and Aaron. So that's not even enough generations to allow 430 years. If you look and see how old they were and how long they lived. There's no way that matches up. And we know that Yahweh's word never fails. If he says 400 years, he meant 400 years, not 430. He says they will go in the servitude and be afflicted. He didn't say the servitude's going to be the whole 400 years, but he says there's going to be affliction and servitude. And he says, and they'll be led captive in every nation. That's what the scripture says. So do you actually know what you think you know? And I want to end on this. We need the word of Yahweh coupled with the Holy Spirit or the Ruach HaKodesh to help us accurately discern the truth and to know what we believe we know or think we know. And with that, I'm going to end this this Tuesday teaching or whatever you want to call it. And I want to say shalom.